Hi, and welcome to the Total Knee Replacement Support Group. In today's video, I want to answer a question from one of our members. She was asking about heel inserts, orthotics, and leg length discrepancies. Now, if you're watching this on YouTube, in the description of this video, you can find a link to our Facebook group. It's a free Facebook group called Total Knee Replacement Support Group 2018 and 19. My name is Tony Maritato. I'm a physical therapist here in Middletown, Ohio. But the group is dedicated to helping individuals who have had a knee replacement or are planning on having a knee replacement get the most out of their recovery and get back to doing the things they love. So if you haven't subscribed to the channel, please take a minute and subscribe now and turn on that notification bell so you're first to be notified when we release a new video. So let's get back to the question. I was asked, what is the best recommended device or insert if there's a leg length discrepancy after a total knee replacement? And let me tell you right now, there is no end to the conversation, borderline arguments around leg length discrepancies. Are they real? Do they exist? Do they matter? Are they causing hip and back pain? You know, how do you measure it? How do you record it? How do you fix it or change it? If you use an insert, does it make things worse? It's just crazy within the profession how far everyone goes to battle against something that, in my opinion, really isn't that big of an issue. Now, here's the thing. If you've been watching any of my content, you know that I'm about the most pragmatic therapist that I could possibly be. Borderline contrarian to what most people are saying in the profession. And I just want you to kind of see the big picture for a second. Now, at the end of the video, I'm going to share with you the inserts, the heel lifts that I do recommend if somebody wants to use them. But by no means does that mean that somebody needs to use them. So let's talk about this kind of, let's put it into context for a minute. I think you all agree, as human beings, we like definitive answers. We like black and white, yes or no. If I give you an apple and then I give you another one, it's pretty easy to say you have two apples. But healthcare, our bodies, human beings, are not apples. We're not black and white. We're not yes, no. It's never that simple. It's like me giving you a bowl of applesauce and trying to say how many apples are in the applesauce. You just don't know. Like, there's so many factors that get into it. So when we're talking about leg length discrepancies, the first thing that I would say is that you're not a machine. You're not a robot. Everything is never symmetrical. There's always asymmetries. And if you've had a knee replacement or you're gonna have a knee replacement, my guess is you already have a leg length discrepancy. Most people before their knee replacement have been walking on a flexed knee that can't go straight, or a hyperextended knee that's hypermobile, or they have a knee that curves out or curves in, varus or valgus. There's hardly ever, I don't know that I've ever met a person who is planning on having or already had a knee replacement who has a perfectly straight knee. Because if they did, they probably wouldn't be getting a knee replacement, right? So we're taking an asymmetrical leg length and we're just making it asymmetrical again after the replacement. But I understand the desire to move toward symmetry, to move toward perfection. And believe me, I spend most of my days working on what we would consider an imbalance and trying to root out the main cause for somebody's condition, whether it's low back pain. And if you would have found me as a clinician 15 years ago, 16 years ago, it would have been my pleasure to talk to you about asymmetries, talk to you about imbalances, talk to you about something as simple as, you know, what is a functional leg length discrepancy? How do we measure it? How do we record it? How do we document changes in it? How, if I put a heel lift in on this side, it's gonna lift the heel, change the angle, you know, of the hip, knee, ankle. We would talk about things like femoral rotation and torsion. There's just so many factors that are involved. It would be wonderful if you were a four-legged table and one of your legs were short and I could put a shim under it and then the table was stable. But that's not what you are, right? You spend 60% of your time standing on one leg while you're walking and the other leg is swinging through the air. You walk on carpet. You walk on bare feet. You walk in shoes. You walk on grass and sand and dirt and rocks. Like, the world we live in is an asymmetrical world. And our bodies are incredibly adaptive. The most adaptive organism I have ever seen. So take heart in kind of understanding and knowing, okay, so if one leg is a little bit shorter after the procedure than it was before, or longer after the procedure than it was before, what does that mean? Does that mean I'm gonna have problems? Does that mean I need to fix this with some sort of outside device? Maybe. You know, the answer is almost always maybe. Try it. If you're experiencing hip pain, I'll give you a very common scenario. So a patient comes in, they had a left total knee replacement. Now, the asymmetry is there, right? It's different than it was before. Let's say, for example, all of a sudden they're getting back to walking, they're moving, and they develop right hip pain. Super common scenario. Left knee replacement, right hip pain, maybe a little bursitis, maybe a little tendinosis, something like that. And so, of course, the first thing we do is we look at the pelvis and we try to line everything up and we say, oh, you're rotated or you're malaligned in some way. Yeah, but they were probably malaligned for the last 20 years and never had hip pain. Why is this the problem now? Don't go to the first, like, possible cause. Dig deeper and ask better questions. So stress, right? Stress of the surgery, healing from the surgery. The immune system isn't doing as well as it was. Certainly you are not as mobile, active after the surgery, and now you're starting to get back to your mobility and your busy lifestyle. So maybe you just overdid it. Like, there are so many factors that can contribute to a contralateral hip pain that just because one leg is longer or shorter, or, you know, the knee isn't as straight or it's straighter than it used to be, or any of those things, that doesn't mean that that's to blame. And it doesn't mean that just because you can put a finger on a mechanical, I'll call it a pathology, but I don't think it's really a pathology, a mechanical problem, that it requires a mechanical solution. Now, I don't know if that answered your question, but I would tell you from my experience, the longer I work as a clinician, the more I realize we don't know everything. We know far less than we like to believe we know. And when I meet somebody who comes across with like a hard, definitive, this is the problem, this is the answer, this is what you need to do, I tend to know that person just has no idea. They don't know what they don't know. The answer should always be, I don't know, but we can try. I don't know, but that makes sense. So let's give this a try. And if it makes you worse, we'll try something else. And as long as it doesn't cost you $1,000 for a pair of custom orthotics that I can't even tell you over 18 years how many custom orthotics I've seen sitting on a shelf that have never been used more than a day or two, and that have cost either the patient or the insurance company $1,500, $2,000. The number is just outrageous. And so I want you to experiment. I want you to dig deep and try to figure out what's causing the problem if you're experiencing one. But at the same time, I want you to understand there really are no absolutes when it comes to healthcare. And so even if a heel lift today helps you, it might hurt you in a month. Or if it doesn't help you today, it might help you in a month. Your body's constantly changing. Your environment's constantly changing. We live in an asymmetrical world. So while you always want to strive to improve, there is no perfection. Okay, long answer. Probably could have been summed up with, I don't know, there's no answer. If you want to try a heel lift, give it a shot. So the ones that I like, what I'll do is I'll put the description and a link to the Amazon sales page in the description of this video. But basically, it's a plastic heel lift. It comes in layers. I think it goes up to a quarter inch. It might be taller than that. I haven't used them for a couple years, but I know they're still available online. And what you do is you get it, you put it in your shoe, you see how it feels, you can break them apart, you can add them together, you can make them taller or shorter. But a couple other factors, if you guys are still watching, is, you know, I know patients who have gotten these really amazing orthotics and they never wear their shoes in the house, right? Now, I love bare feet. I'm a huge advocate of bare feet. I don't think you need super expensive shoes. I've had patients buy $10 Keds and be very happy. Crocs, Keds, there's so many options out there. But I will say, just again, like, ask a better question. So if you're gonna get an orthotic or a heel lift, you gotta think, well, if I'm at home in bare feet 5 to 8 hours a day, it's not really gonna help or make a difference. If I'm wearing different shoes for work and leisure and exercise, you know, am I gonna move this heel lift or orthotic into every different pair of shoes that I have? Like, is the shoe, you know, it's one thing to create, we used to do this, you'd do the foot mold and you'd create this perfect orthotic that put that foot and ankle into just the ideal, most sweet position. But then you'd put it into a shoe that was half broken down and crooked and rolling over onto the side. And it turned an amazing orthotic into a useless piece of junk. So, like, there's a big difference between the orthotic that sits on the floor and you test it and you put your feet in there and your arches are perfect and subtalar neutral and all that stuff. But then what are the shoes you're putting it into? You know, so just remember, your body is amazingly adaptive. There is no right or wrong answer. If you want to give it a shot, if it costs $15, $20, I think it's affordable, I think it's worth the risk. You do it, you put it in, maybe you feel amazing and that would make me so happy and I would love for you to share that comment in the group. Maybe you put it in, it just bugs you, it hurts, it causes heel pain, it causes other problems. No big deal, take it out, you know, don't use it again. Save it in case you need it down the road. But that is the best answer I could give you, is it depends on your situation. It depends on lots of factors that none of us really, we don't have the brain power to put every single thing into, you know, the shaker, mix it up and come out with the right answer. So you gotta just start experimenting, give it your best guess. Check out the link, look at the ones that I've used, and then if you see something you like better, give it a shot. Hopefully that helps. Post your questions, because I know I threw a lot out there. And if you still are better informed than you were before watching this video, I apologize. But hopefully it prompts you to kind of ask another question and then we can keep diving into it. Guys, as always, subscribe to the channel, turn on the notifications so you know when we release a new video, and I hope you have the best possible experience after your knee replacement, because I know the challenges that you've gone through to get it. Now I want you to enjoy it. I'll catch you in the next video.